All right, you ready?
Yep.
This podcast. So we are live on Collins Conversations. I'll let you introduce yourself, let everybody know who you are, how you got here, and a little bit about what you do.
All right. My name is DeAndre Bush. Some of you may know me as Visk, V-I-S-Q. I'm an actor. Went to school for Media Arts Digital Filmmaking. As you can tell by the accent, I'm not originally from Cleveland. I'm from Alabama. So I've been doing acting for a while, and music is just a side thing for me to do. Express my emotions, to vent, just like people who write or do spoken word poetry. So I've been in Cleveland about 9 years, and I really like the music scene. It's very diverse, much different from Alabama, where it's just one plain type of genre, basically, trap music and stuff like that. So Cleveland's a good place just to come and really get that city vibe. Mm-hmm. Instead of going to like bigger places like New York or Los Angeles, like Cleveland's like that nice little pocket where you can learn how to hustle, how to start businesses, how to interact with different cultures. And I'm here today with Colin, and you'll learn a little bit more about me.
Awesome. So let's kind of unpack that a little bit. What brought you from Alabama to Cleveland?
It wasn't my choice personally, but it was family reasons. We had some personal stuff going on with the family, immediate family. So we had two choices, either go somewhere further up in Alabama or come to Cleveland. And we already had family in Cleveland, so it was a smart decision just to come straight to Cleveland.
Gotcha. So there's family here. It wasn't kind of just like throwing a dart at the map and you're like, all right, that landed in Cleveland. I guess we're going to go be Cleveland and put on Brown sweaters.
Not a Browns fan, but I see her wear.
How'd you come up with your rap name?
It's the most randomest thing ever. I didn't use a name generator, but I was like, I want something kind of weird, but very short, so people can remember or they can just type in really quickly. So I was using like, see, Drake, 5 letters. I was like, but I want something different, unique. And I was like, Cisco got a very nice, interesting name. So I was trying to think of something that fits around his theme. I was like, So I was on my computer just coming up with different names, like Lil Dre, like, oh, this started to be done too many times. And I had like my Visa card right here. And I was just looking at it, I was like, something like Visa, they got like 4 letters. And I was like, looking at it, but I look at the computer, I'm like, Cisco, Dre, 4 letters would be good. And I was like, Vis. And other people, I like Visa, and I like Cisco. And I was just going back and forth, and I was just like, it just came Visk. I just took like the Q from Cisco and I'm like, just remove the A. The V-I-S-Q, I'm like it, it's short. I'm like, how do I pronounce that? And I was like, Visa, Visk. People like Visk, they love saying Visk. I was like, Visk.
I read it like Visk. So, I guess maybe I just don't agree. You know? But kind of like you're almost laughing at your own logic, but I'm taking one step away from that and you're thinking, thong songs and money. Who doesn't like, you know, kind of.
It comes together.
You put it together, it might work out.
And then, which is for tip for artists, if you're going for a name, make sure you search and see if there's like any other like trademarks or if somebody already got that domain name.
Right.
Or on social media, could they? Nobody got it, then you know that's a good name.
True. That, and if I would take one thing with that too, if you are just starting a persona, make sure that you go to Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, 5 other big ones, and make sure that it's available on every one. So it's not Visk here, Visk underscore here. To make one name across the board, it makes everything so much easier.
Mm-hmm.
I took that logic from before I started doing social media. I knew domain names. One of those, if why would I start a company if Launch for Less wasn't available, which I did, by the way. LaunchForLess.com was taken when I started Launch for Less Landscaping. So I ended up with LaunchForLess.biz, but in my head, it worked out because you knew it was a business, opposed to, you
it's
know.
It's a daily domain, though.
it worked for 10 years and it kept me employed. So, you know, it got people there, and once they were there, I made sure everything, you know, was in line and it worked out. I think you hit it on the head right there when you said that you do music to kind of vent and show your feelings. I mean, your music has a lot of feelings and everything. And that's how we got here was I put up a post and it was kind of just like, hey, I'm looking to review some music for ColinCanHelp.com. And I think same day I had an email saying, hey, it's DeAndre, you know, yeah. I got this new project out, can you check it out? And of course, you know, any it's amazing how many times you offer that free service of like, hey, just trying to look and expose people, meet new stuff, and people just don't respond to it. But then they'll pay $100 to go get some likes or whatever. You're like, I'm trying to give you real content here, you right. know? So when did the music thing start?
I think I was about 14 when I actually first started doing music. Mostly I was just doing like poetry, just writing stuff like for my creative writing class. And the area where I was from in Alabama is like a real small country town. So anything that's like outside of the box creatively was looked at as weird, or like kids were always joking and bullying. Like, oh, he's a nerd, gay, blah, 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 look at this. So basically I used to write my stuff down, and some of the local kids like used to rap outside after school. I used to always like watch them, interact, whatever. And I was like, okay, it's pretty easy. I'm gonna start, you know, making music. And so he was like, oh, Bush, you can't rap. He used to always call me my last name, Bush. They thought I was related to George Bush for some weird reason.
Must be because you guys look identical.
Yeah, very identical. And they're like, oh, Bush, you can't rap. Bush, you can't do this. You can't do that. So whatever I try to do, whether it's sports, basketball, music, playing instruments, they're like, oh, you can't do this. I was like trying to bring me down. So I had to fight through that. And then eventually, after, you know, a couple school fights, earned my respect. And they was like, oh, yeah, Bush, cool. Yeah, yeah, you do this, you do that. I was like, oh. Last year you was saying all this shit about me, blah, blah, blah. But, so I think 14 from all the way to now, I've been doing music consistently. 2013 was the first year I actually put out an EP. I put it on SoundCloud. I didn't really like share my music because I didn't know how it was going to be perceived. And I was like, maybe my music a little bit too weird, or some people may not like it. And it was like, right before like that big wave of like SoundCloud rappers came out with all like the weird different type of music, I was like, fuck, I could have rode that wave. But I just shared it with like my media friend. They're like, you know, you should promote it, you know, put more out there. So 2015 was the first year I actually like fully promoted, like right after I was out of school, and I just, all right, I'm gonna promote this, do my acting, I'm gonna do music, just to showcase my skills, because you never know.
Right. And I'm really interested. I've got next to no musical ability. I know how to listen to music. I hate dancing, but like I'm always listening to different things. I'm always interested in the creative process. It kind of sounds like you like to do both the lyrics and you're making your own beats, or do you kind of find beats from other people? How does a typical song normally come together?
I use other people's beats. Mm-hmm. I have tried like in the past to make, I made like a couple of beats, but it was pretty standard.
Right.
I would say, the process is I find a producer where they'll let you use the beat for profit, right, and just give them credit. So I listen to a couple of them. And I usually find like a smaller channel where we just network and just build that type of relationship. Then I'll listen to a couple. I'm always writing stuff. So whenever I come across a beat, and if that beat fits into like any one of my writers, I'm like, okay, I can use this for this. Even though it's an older song, I think I can make it work. So I record most of all my music on my laptop. I don't really got like a home studio. I just have like the microphone, laptop, and I just go at it.
Right.
I went to a couple producers in Cleveland. Skunk Studio is a pretty good one. Shout out to Skunk. Britt Fox Studios is another one. She's a very good engineer. Lots of experience, and I just like, even though if I don't go to them all the time, I just like supporting like those businesses because I know how it is. All
right.
Just to even just do like one song with them and then go to another producer, do another one. And it's just how you build relationships. You got to network, you got to talk.
Recording people that are in Cleveland, if you're looking kind of just to kind of branch out and find different sounds, Ty C. Ty C, we're still waiting to get you on the show. Ty C's a great guy. Kind of, as a musical producer, the only complaint anybody's ever come up with, being me, being anybody. He's done some things with him. But
I talked with him a little bit.
Gotcha. Yeah, go work with him. But that dude, my only criticism is he makes shit sound too clean. Like,
it is.
Kind of, you hear somebody sing or whatever, and you're like, dude, they're never gonna be able to recreate that. You know, like, you made them sound like a motherfucking angel.
Yeah.
You know, but him and then Adi Ray of Invasion Studios. Do you know Adi?
I don't think I do.
They're over in Maple Heights. That's another one.
I heard of the studio, but.
Yeah, they're blowing up studio-wise. I just saw them on Instagram today saying they're getting so booked up, you know, it's kind of building up a waiting list, which is always a good sign.
That's, yeah, that's really
Curly cool. Chuck does a lot of recording over there.
Okay.
That's where I filmed the Curly Chuck interview that came out this week.
He's probably taking up all the studio time, this probably.
No, he says he's too busy. He's not doing like he used to, but it's always a packed house. I've been in there to do the interview with Adi and Curly, and it's every time it's like 20 people, you know. You got a couple guys working, got a couple guys hanging out, got a couple guys getting ready to work. It's
nice.
But again, kind of the same way any business gets busy, you know. Adi, Will, all those guys put out such quality recordings that, you know, I can get in there for 30-40 bucks an hour and make a banger. Like, of course, let me get in there, opposed to paying some guy that who knows how much money he wants for who knows if he's going to do it. Like,
right.
You hear people sing and you're like, how are they going to recreate that? She made them sound like 8 different levels of themselves. Like, it's amazing what the guys that know how to use these programs can do. But definitely check out SirFaded.com.
Okay.
That's a producer out of somewhere in Texas. But he does a lot of almost every beat that you hear on my podcast lately is come from him, or freebeats.io is another good one. Same thing, like you're saying, kind of give credit for them, and you can use any of their beats for commercial use. We kind of touched on it. I hate how artists kind of just sit on stuff. How do you know a song is ready to release?
I say it's probably one of my least traits that I'm still working on, because I'll write something, I'll be like, I want to release this right now. This is amazing. And then I'll sit on it, or I have something that's really kind of old. It's been out for written two or three years ago, and I'm like, I guess I'll just add this to my new project. That's how when you was critiquing, you probably like, well, this didn't really seem like it fit the theme, because I slid that song in there just so I can finally get it out and start procrastinating. As an artist, sometimes it's, some people like to get their stuff out sooner than later, so I don't have to wait until they get like the buzz or something behind it, which is smart for like a marketing standpoint. You just gotta bridge that gap to know when the right time to release it and when to sit on it, because you just never know. One song may blow up off an impulse, or another song may take 3 years to blow up. Like, this is one artist, St. Night Lavelle. I don't know if you ever heard of him, he's like a UK rapper. You never know when your music is gonna.
I think that's one of those kind of people are still thinking with that old school mentality of, you know, oh, I gotta build a buzz, I gotta do my press kit, I gotta do blah, blah, blah. That was 100% accurate, I think, before the digital age. But now with the internet, like you said, I personally, as a marketer, would consult and recommend to just about any creative, as soon as you have it done, put it on the internet. Because, like you said, one day, somebody might see it, and the quicker it's there, the quicker that avalanche, that tumble can kind of happen of share, click. Or if you have it, even if you don't think it's polished and ready, if you put it out there and critique is like, it's half-assed, blah, 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 you know it's not ready, but maybe somebody else is like, this is great.
Yeah.
And what about music? Are you always going to be hip-hop, or are you going to kind of go try to do different genres in music, or?
I have dabbled with like different genres, like the main would be like hip hop. You know, like I'll try to find like some metal sounds into it, or like some electronic. Like, I like the versatile of my music, just like I do my acting.
Mm-hmm.
And it just, you become a better artist once you listen to like other types of music and reach out to other fans, because that's where the money's at. Like, if you got just one set, like your whole life, you're not pulling income from different types of. That's why Drake is so successful, because he went into like pop, he went into reggae, like he went into these different avenues, and that's how you become a really successful artist. Just you don't gotta do a whole album. It's like metal bass or whatever. As long as you just bring some of those sounds in, like a genre blending type of album, I think you have like a huge appeal to everybody.
So let's go into another thing I like to do. How confident are you on your own music? Could I fool you on your own music?
Yeah, go ahead.
Something I do with a lot of musicians lately is called the lyric test.
Oh.
Where I play a song and I stop it and you have to finish the line. If you don't, I get a point. If you do, you get a point.
How many points to win?
We're only going to do 3 songs just for the sake of time purposes.
All right.
I'm going to go some of your newer, some of your older, and we're going just off of what's on iTunes, Apple Music, because that's the only one I give my monies to. So let's go. Are you more confident in my newer stuff or older stuff? Doesn't matter?
I'll let you do it.
All right. I already kind of alluded to this, but this became my favorite song this afternoon. So is there any story behind Real Recognize Real? How did this song come to fruition?
Most of my songs come together kind of weird. That song in particular, it was, how can I put it? There was like a video I was watching, I think it was, I can't remember the group name right now, but they got like these psychedelic type videos. And I just like playing with like those colors and just coming up with different types of, like with my music, I come up with different types of characters for these moves.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm having like a really happy day, I track this character that got like this inspirational type of vibe, or if I'm having a bad day, you might hear something like that romance, love type shit. And I like bringing my acting to my music. So for that one in particular, I just imagine myself as like this character in like this psychedelic LSD type of world. You know, I never done LSD, but just the effects. And I just wanted to bring that effect into music so you can like have a feeling of what it is without actually doing it.
LSD is the topic of the podcast lately. Curly Chuck, the last episode, he loves LSD. He said if he was a drug, he would be LSD.
That's right.
And there's a clip coming out soon, I forget when I got it scheduled, of Curly Chuck's Tips to Trippin'. It gives us the full 1-2 on everything you need to know in case you did decide to try a little tab or whatnot. Shout out to Curly Chuck. He was a great guy to interview. I met him at Scuff Mixon's birthday party, first time, and kind of...
That's so random. Birthday party.
It was amazing barbecue. Name dropping time for the barbecue. Kipstone, if you know Kipstone.
I heard of it, yeah.
New Franklin.
Mm-hmm.
Like
I like his music. I checked him out. Like, okay, I like
Nuke.
This. Yeah,
Nuke is insane. I've got Nuke. You watch this stuff. You need to drop that. What is this? Stuck on My Ass. Drop that song. We got great content behind that. Drop that shit. That's the roughest shit, dude. It's like podcasting is great. You kind of get that behind the scenes. You know, different musicians kind of let me preview a little bit of stuff or send with the reviews. It's like, hey, you got something coming out. Let me get it. Let me get a review out for you. But things like that song, or Scuff Mixon has this psychic vampire. You're not waiting until December. Put it out. You know, you're like, you hear these things, and you're like, how could they just sit on this in the vault? Like, you got this in the vault, and you're like, not ready to put it out, or whatever reason. You're like, I know there's logic behind it, but you're like, man, as a fan, I love the sound. I don't know the difference between it's fully mastered and 80% mastered. Just, you know, shoot it out and let me get it. But Nuke is we're about to get into the lyric test, is the only one that I fooled on the lyrics since I've done this. I went deep enough in his archive. I love Nuke Town, and apparently that's not his favorite project. And I went deep enough in his newer stuff, like was just fresh on the brain. It was great. Kip was on the couch, like off camera, and like the third one, he's like, I know this one, you need help. Kip is actually going to be on the show pretty soon. I'm looking really forward to that. He's another one of those where like he's been on the radar and either scheduling or whatever, but he's got a new project coming out. So we're going to kind of help try to promote that with the podcast. Without further ado, though, let's get to the lyric test. This is off of Metamorphosis. This is 2018, so it's kind of fresh, kind of not. Let's see, we'll go a little bit further in.
They got a lot of pauses in this song. Party at 9 for the with some fun freeze.
Party at 9 for the fun freeze. One for one. Right on. Let's go to something off Voices in My Head. Let's see. What's your favorite song off this project?
Mm. I would say Voices in My Head or Demons in the Rain. They're like my two. But Demons in the Rain is like my most creative one.
So let's not go with those. See, there's some logic in my question. Let's try to up the ante on this one. We're going to go with Press Play. Is there any stories behind this, or is this kind of just a fun song? What's behind the door here?
That one was actually a girl, a female that I met at an Airbnb when I was in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
She was just happened to be there when I was getting in, and we chatted up, started talking. She was pretty cool.
And then Press Play happened. So I'll Press Play.
All right. We met a new song for this with the sleeping. Sorry, my dream.
You did what?
We got to take out for two.
Okay.
Wearing them jeans, watching his wing. She's a queen looking for a king.
Wearing them jeans, watching his wing. She's a queen looking for a king.
Two for two. And we'll go with something off the... It's one of those things where, like... People always get kind of nervous when they're on the spot and it's a test, but she's like, you wrote the test. You can't get much easier there.
I'm an actor. I always got to be prepared.
Let's go here. Let's go. If anybody needs to know anything else about They Can't Stand Me, ColinCanHelp.com has a great review. Well, I think it's great. We don't know how did you like the review?
I liked it. It gave me constructive criticism because I noticed the mistakes before you poured them out, like the intro. I was like, oh yeah, I did try to, but it was too late. All right, I already released it.
Right? Yeah, it's one. I used to hate grammar, like in middle school, high school things. And then once I owned a business and started designing flyers and things like that, like grammar and spelling has become, like, my wife hates me. She'll be in the middle of, like, trying to scrape me out in a text, and I'm like, wrong there. Like, I can't help it. Like, you're an asshole. I'm just trying to help you, you know? But I'm glad you said that, because every review that I try to do, I always try to, all music's not for everybody at the same time and things like that, but there's good and bad in every artistic thing, and it's obviously subjective, what you think is good, what I think is good, completely different things, but I always try to, this is just what it is, like, this, I have no full opinion, you can get that at the very end, but like, this is, you know, a more rap song. This is more creative song. Kind of, oh, this is good, this is good, this is bad. I wouldn't do this, you know. It's kind of, and again, I'm not the musician, but as somebody that does marketing, as somebody that listens to music, like, that ear is different than the creative. But if you put both those together, I think that's how you kind of make classic stuff, you know.
Yeah, that's what I like about your review, because if you review it, you have, like, this way that you see it, then somebody else might review it, have a different way.
Exactly.
And that's how I think, like, people should make music, to have, like, different perspectives, because, like, even the artist may have, like, an abstract idea of what they want to paint, but then other people are like, oh, I see this in this painting, or I see this in this painting.
Right.
And just getting that constructive criticism is good. So, future artists, don't take it as an offense. It's not a personal attack. Take the criticism, learn from it, build on it.
And let's go from this one. Are you woke or awake? How did this one come?
That was, yeah, I know it.
You know this one off the bat? Are there any good stories behind it or any behind the scenes things people should know?
For that one, it was more so just like looking like around your surroundings, like how the world is, you know, is going right now.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of my work is kind of abstract, but if you really, like, see like, the type of things I'm putting together, you're like, okay, I understand where he's trying to...
Right.
I like putting the music, like, in the... basically pulling the listener into this character's shoes so they can see this world that's around them.
I listened to this project first before I listened to anything, or before I even realized you were an actor. But once I realized that you were an actor, a lot of more things made sense to where... Like you said, you're trying to pull people into different characters where a lot of it isn't the most, what am I trying to say, polished music, but it's kind of gives you that, if you follow the words of what you're saying, and I think I put this in a couple songs for the review, if you follow it, you're like, all right, this dude's clearly trying to paint a picture, and it's a vivid picture. Kind of take yourself away from him just trying to bob your head to like actually listen to it, and it's kind of just like... The audible storyboard of what a video or a music or even just a full short film would be.
That's what Anna from Cleveland.com said when she reviewed that Voices in My Head one.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing, yeah.
So let's go into Are You Woke or Awake?
The more I became so great, understand things don't break.
Hey, I don't hate the now. Is it worthwhile? Can I even see the hate? Man, can't
watch me not, right?
Hey, I don't hate it now. Is it worthwhile? Can't even hold the hate, man. Blood is at the rate. Decode the deconstruction of a superhero. Warp speed, catching bullets and making zero.
I understand plenty, leaning off the henny. Say they gonna kill me.
Killed it. 3 out of 3, you aced Visk University. Congratulations. On the music tip, let's plug this back so we can actually get real and record. Did I do it backwards since I started with the most recent and kind of went backwards in the chronologically?
Yeah. But that's what I like though. That way you'd be like, oh, he just this type, and you're like, oh shit. This is way much different.
I think I put it in the review I did for yours of kind of listening to it gave me that feeling of kind of there's quality here. This isn't polished yet, but like 2 or 3 more albums from now, or 2 or 3 more projects,
yeah.
Or kind of the collection of, you know, from The Face of Many to Metamorphosis to Voices in My Head to They Can't Stand Me. Like, I guarantee of those 4 there's at least 1 or 2 from each project that's downloaded to where, you know, by the time you get 3 or 4 more of those, if I go 1 or 2, I got 10 songs of this that are like, all right, these are my everyday listens, you know?
That's what I like for people. Like, you at least find 1 song on any of my albums that you would like.
Right.
And that's what I like, because then you can have, like, a piece from everything.
Absolutely.
And just make it like a collection. Yeah.
You said you're doing all your stuff yourself. Are you Mac? Are you PC? How are you recording?
I use PC because that's what I have. I have a Surface Pro. If I did have a Mac, I would love use Logic and all those other programs, but yeah, PC.
One of my favorite segments is, what are your top 3 apps that you use in a given day?
Robinhood, Instagram. It's a toss up between Twitter and Facebook at the moment. Both of them same. I say Twitter.
So you're doing stocks and building your brand. It sounds like is what you're doing throughout your day. Those that don't know about Robinhood is great. Colin R84, if you want to sign up, use that code right there so you can get a free stock. I can get a free stock. Not sponsored, but they do get free stocks. And it's free stock trading. What would you say about Robinhood if you had to give a 30-second explanation of what it is?
Robinhood is basically a streamlined process where you can invest in stocks and cryptocurrency, just like the big ballers do, and you don't need a lot of money. Like, you can invest with like $2. So it's not like you gotta put your whole paycheck into like a stock, but it's real simple on your phone.
And the big thing is it's no fees for buying and selling. So
no fees.
You know, if you go to Scott Trade or something like that,
yeah.
You buy a stock for $10, it goes up $2, but it costs $7 to buy it and $4 to sell it. You need to get a double up before you make any money. Where with Robinhood, you buy a $3 stock, it goes up to $3.50, you can cash out right there, and you're right there. Have you seen that Cash App now has stocks?
I have. I saw the cryptocurrency one.
It's going to be interesting to see how that affects Robinhood, because with Cash App, you can do fractional stocks. So the other day I bought like $12 of Berkshire Hathaway.
That's
not going anywhere. I had $12 to put somewhere. I found out about it through Joe Rogan, because Joe Rogan is my Oprah. Through all that I'm doing here, I'm trying to be the Joe Rogan and the Jamie Vernon all in one.
Okay.
And I want to be the guy that's from JR Eclipse and clip all my shit out and kind of go that route. But that's kind of like the blueprint of like 10 years from now, that's where Colin's conversations is going to be. But I learned about that this Cash App thing through them, and I was like, perfect. I just cut a log for somebody. They paid me $40 through Cash App. I was like, let's see what it's all about, you know. So I went and bought like 15 different, couple dollars here, couple dollars there, and the only difference from Robinhood is as soon as you sell, they take like the government tax out. Like,
yeah.
I think I made like a 5-something, just to kind of see how the selling and everything worked. I think it was like a 1 cent tax or something, which, you know, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
But to be able to buy a fractional of, you know, Facebook is a couple $100 a share. Apple, Amazon is two grand a share or something like that. So if you can kind of just get in at a couple dollars each week and keep throwing it at it, like, it's a brilliant thing. Cash App is amazing.
It's passive income.
What's your favorite form of passive income?
Well, stocks is definitely one of them.
Have you been into stock trading long?
I think this would be my second year. Like, I knew about it, like, well, like, in 2015, right when I was still in school. I hate bringing this up because I was thinking about Bitcoin before it exploded.
I kick myself so often. When Bitcoin was first, I used to sell computers at Micro Center, 2009. Like, what, you know, seems like ages ago. But back then, I knew about Bitcoin because there's all the nerds around everybody. And at that point, it was, I don't know, a couple of dollars. It was affordable. But the only people that were using Bitcoin were drug dealers and criminals on the black market. And I was like, I was so afraid to buy a Bitcoin because I was like, that's got to just be like signing up to say, hey, I'm a criminal. And then, you know, 10 years go by, if I would have put $5, and I would have been a fucking millionaire. But I was afraid of being labeled a criminal.
I had $100 I could have got in Bitcoin, and it was still pretty cheap. I think it was around 20 or 19 a share. And if I would put $100, I could have had at least 4 shares. And I could have just sat on that. But it was so many articles like, oh, Bitcoin's gonna crash. All these fear mongering articles. I was like, oh, I don't wanna lose $100. I still need this, whatever.
Yeah, I took a hit with the Robinhood app. I invested in, this is what I love about podcasting. It starts about music and shit. We're like, oh, let's do stock. That way, I got more footage for Colin Can Help instead of Colin's Conversations. Yeah. And then they're like, yeah, this dude, perhaps he does music and he's investing advice. Amazing. But the weed stocks, dude, they killed me.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's one of those, you know, it's a booming market. And then there's, I'm not going to say the name of them. Because I hate them. I don't want to give them any type of publicity.
Aurora.
But
is it Aurora?
No, it's not. That's one of the big ones. Canopy Trust is who it is. Yeah. I bought only like $50 worth. You know, not a lot, but at the time it was like $4 or $5 a share. The fucking weekend I bought it, there's a big story about they were, I forget if they were just growing too many plants or if they were selling their things on the black market still. And I'm like, come on, man. It dropped like 80% in like a month and a half. And it's one of those, like, on the Robinhood app, it's still listed as a buy. So they're, you know, eight out of 10 analysts or whatever say it's going to come back. But, like, that's the hardest thing of nowadays, being able to just a live thing on your thing, on your phone. And it's, they say you're going to come back, but I'm looking at a negative $50 return on you. Why didn't I go with more of this stock or that stock? I first started when I wanted to do like 7 different segments with this podcast because I had no idea how much fucking time was involved in doing the podcast when I first started. And one of them was building a portfolio on $150. I wanted to do a daily like investing type thing. Reason I stopped doing it is, do you know how boring of content it is when you're doing those slow like 20 cent gain, sell, buy, whatever, you know?
Day trade.
Yeah, just pretty much like every other day trade, you know, like hold for 2 or 3 days is trying to find something that goes up 10% so you can buy something else. But within kind of, it's amazing how I used to be really interested in sports. Like, I'd be able to tell you this, you know, Indians are here, Cavs are winning this, blah, blah, blah. Now I know nothing about that, but you're like, oh, what do you know about Disney? I know they're down 14% and blah, blah, blah. You know, it's amazing how, like, as you grow older and you're like, I used to just buy weed, and then you're like, oh, why was I a teenager buying weed where I could have bought weed stock that would have paid for anything I wanted to do if I bought it back, you know?
Right.
Like, it's crazy how some people have that mind of like, all right, let's buy $10 of Pepsi instead of buying $10 of actual Pepsi. You know, it's amazing how many people with Robinhood, with Cash App, are still afraid to kind of invest in themselves and buy stocks and kind of diversify their things.
That's the mindset.
What is your song? I should have done better research. I should know songs. But you have one of your newer ones on They Can't Stand Me where you have 2 or 3 different dividend lines.
Yeah.
I think you're the only rapper that I know of that's talking about dividends and cash flows.
Hey.
In a way that's not just like, money, 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 hoes, hoes, hoes. You're like, no, I got dividends, you know? Do you invest in stocks that don't have dividends?
I do. There's UGAS. I don't know if you heard of them or not.
UGAS.
It's like a natural gas.
Okay.
So you guys and this one brand called Naked. They do like intimate, like underwear and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Those I'm watching pretty close because Naked's like 4 cents right now. Gotcha. But like the volume is like 10 million. So like, people, they're like manipulating the market. But like if that goes up to what Lulu is, that Lululemon.
Right. The ridiculously expensive pants.
Yeah. If they shoot, I have like 600 and some shares in Naked at 4 cents a share. So that goes up to like $20. Like, that's a couple grand right there.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
So you like kind of going with that risky kind of penny stock mentality opposed to going with the, you know, the big names.
I have bid a couple, like when I was really like investing, when I had like the money. Nokia, I was doing Nokia, I was doing, most of the big names I do like day trading, mm-hmm. just so I can get that quick money instead of like buying like $100 worth of shares. Get a couple from Microsoft when I knew that was gonna go up. Get a call and got it pretty good. Got a $200 return. I'm like, yeah, okay, nice. One day you're gonna lose like $200. You're like, fuck, this shit supposed to go up. But those are the ones I'm watching close because UGAS goes up when it's cold outside and DGAS goes up when it's hot. So people play those like every year, summertime, wintertime. So I don't know how bad this winter is going to be. So if it's a very bad winter, make a lot of money.
Right.
But it's a very nonchalant winter. I still make some gains, but
it's a much better idea than going out snow plowing.
Yeah.
For sure. Yeah, lately, like you said, I kind of like to find those ones where a lot of people are like, oh, why do you want something that's going up and down 10% every other day? Because if I hit it, if it goes down 10% today and it goes back to where it was yesterday, I'll sell it tomorrow and make 10%. It's pretty easy profit. And I used to love gambling. Where I said I used to be really into sports, I also used to love going to the casino. Like, roulette and craps was my shit. Like, if I could just go in and... I realized it was probably like a year. I didn't lose. Like, I would lose, like, I would very conservative gamble. You know, I'd take 100, 200 bucks, you know, play the $5, $10 tables and kind of, they hate me at a craps table. I'm always playing the don't pass, which it's amazing at a casino. People get mad at you for playing the don't pass. It's the smartest bet on the entire craps table.
They want you to blow that money.
They're looking at, like, me putting my chips here is going to affect their toss. Like, no, man, just throw your dice. You're going to hit a seven, you're going to win money, you're going to laugh at me, and then you know what you're going to do the next time? You're going to not get your point. And then you know what happens is my $5 chip turns to another $5 chip. I did that 20 times, I got $100. You know? So like, I just never lost, and then I hit this streak where I just couldn't fucking win. And then I was like, why do people gamble? Like, this is the dumbest thing I've ever done.
You always said it when you lose money. When you're like, oh yeah, I love gambling.
Right. And I was one of the rare people that I know that actually would be honest. Like when I come back, everybody says they won when they went to the casino. I was like, no, I would never go to get rich. And I think that's the key where a lot of people fuck up is I would go with $100 and if I could go to Erie, you know, it's way better than going to Cleveland in my opinion, just because I like the casino better. So I could go, as long as I get my gas to drive there and back, get some food, get 20 or 30 bucks in my pocket, what better type of vacation is it to go get free food, free travel, and come back with 30 bucks?
Yeah.
What's your favorite casino type game?
I usually play the machines. I'm not much of a...
Oh, not the machines. You got... That's just complete rape right there. You have no hand in the game there.
Yeah, they are pretty bad. But I don't like spend a lot of money, but I could probably see like $20 just for the machines. Right. Sometimes I get lucky and I come out with like $80-some, but it doesn't happen like consistently. I'd be like, fuck you, Julebee. But
I always tell people, they're like, oh, no, you gotta play the slots. That's where the jackpot's at. But you think of every casino, there's what, 8 to 10 tables.
Yeah, it's a lot.
And 400,000 slot machines. If you were a business, which would you do more of? The things you made money on or the things you might not make as much on?
Right.
They're still making their money, but you know, like, there's no reason there's 8,000 slot machines. And you see the old people, dude. They got their cigarette, their gas tank, their drink, and they're just pulling. You're like, excuse me, ma'am, you just won $400. What? What? You didn't even enjoy the win. Like, it's just a rotary motion. They're just so used to it. Until that pack of cigarettes is gone and your money is gone, then they gotta go home.
And you're like, no, I only want $10. Like, you have 400. You paid attention.
Right. What is the biggest tip for you to start a conversation? Clearly, you're not afraid of being in front of a camera or, yeah, or meeting somebody new. What helps you meet new people? Get those icebreakers in. Mm-hmm.
It's different for every person, but for me personally, since I dive into like so many different topics, like I can just fit in like any role. But basically, just talk to people. Like, people are just so afraid. Well, I won't say afraid. I would just say
hesitant. I think
hesitant to just say something to somebody. I know everybody got their headphones in, or like they're on the phone or doing whatever. But if you're like in an event, especially if you're like a creative event, just go up to a random person where they're just standing there, just like, hey, what brought you to this event? Like, you never know who may be at that event.
Right.
Could be an agent, could be a sponsor, could be a successful businessman, a woman. Like, you just never know who you may find. You just go up and just talk to them. Even they're not even paying you no mind.
Right.
Even just those few words, they can be like, hey, I remember that person from this event. I'm gonna chop it up. Basically, just being the action that you want to see.
Kind of, as soon as you said those things, what came to mind for me was how I envisioned your engagement with Nicolas Cage. Of kind of, you see a big celebrity, a lot of people are kind of like, oh, that's that guy, you know, I'm a friend, I'm a nobody, blah, blah, blah. But if he's like, oh, hey, buddy, how you doing today? You know, it's kind of just. And he'll see that, and anybody sees that, they're like, oh, they gave me eye contact, they made a gesture. At bare minimum, I'm going to say, hey, and keep walking. Or next thing you know, maybe you're in a movie and just doing whatever it is that you never thought, just because you opened a door that people would have just been like, oh, it's not open. It's kind of turn right.
Right.
Has there ever been a time where you weren't this comfortable and confident? Kind of, you said, it seems like when you were in Alabama, you were kind of insecure about at least your creative sides.
Yeah.
What got you through kind of overcoming that those insecurities?
Besides the fighting.
A couple of asses and, you know, things are a little bit different.
I would say once you find, like, your tribe, that's when you can finally, like, okay, there's other people who see the world the same way I do. I would say I didn't really start expressing myself publicly until I came to Cleveland. Like, it was just such a new place for me, so it was just...
That whole kind of just, you got to rebuild yourself. But nobody knew anything about Alabama. You're like, it's Cleveland me, man, I got this.
But it's just more so just growing and learning to be yourself, which is ironically my name for my next EP that I'm gonna release. I don't know when, but it's called It's Okay Being Yourself, or It's Okay Being You. So even you just feel like, oh, I'm weird, or feeling this way, there's somebody else who's exactly like you in that sense. And it's just, be open, tell people what you like, tell people, like, you know, it's just so much stigma with being yourself nowadays. Like, sometimes you be like, oh yeah, they made it because they're just being real, they're just being themselves. Mm-hmm. You don't gotta be fake to make it. You know, be yourself, and you can just get that organic growth just from being yourself. Because somebody else, there's a whole industry that's for everybody.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
There's a thing that goes around on the internet that I think I really take, especially doing what I do, just I spend so many hours editing video and finding guests and everything, where it was, create what you create because you never know who it inspires. You know, I could put out a clip, that clip you just put there, I could have an idea that, oh, that's gonna inspire people to go make music, but it might make somebody not want to kill themselves or try something new, or, you know, it's amazing, like, the interpretation of your art could have so many chain reactions. And I think even if it's not a monetary thing right off the bat, you're like, oh, that guy at the party is like, hey, are you Colin from Colin's Conversations? And you're like, I'm a fucking celebrity. There's four people that know me ever. But you're like, aren't you that guy from the internet? You're like, it's that cool thing. You're like, oh, cool. That time that I'm putting in, like, eventually what I'm doing is going to snowball. And like you said, kind of one day everybody hits that peak. And then you're like, oh, this guy's been doing it for 10 years. he's had 1,000 episodes I can go through. I love his show now, you know?
Yeah.
It's amazing how that snowball could happen. Mm-hmm. Being an actor, how do you get acting work? If somebody is like yourself and wants to start acting, what do you do to go find different roles or get into different projects?
Well, I would say if you are in Cleveland area, the best way to do is go on Facebook, and there's a lot of casting agencies that post daily looking for, especially if they're like films in town. Mm-hmm. So right now there's 2 films in town, Cherry and Untitled Fred Hampton Project. And I was on both those sets as an extra. And Angela Baum is somebody you should go on Facebook and look up and add as a friend. She's a casting director. Her, Lillian Powell's, Marcy Rowan. So it's like about 4 different cast agencies in Cleveland. And they always looking for people for commercials, movies, short films, sometimes music videos, and they all pay. So that, and also just network with like Tri-C students, CSU students, cause like people in the film classes, especially their seniors, they need like actors for their final projects. So you can just go and audition, then that leads to something else, because most of my roles that I got, it was from people that was like on previous sets that I did. And I was like, hey, I sent your headshot to this one director that I'm working with on this one film. They're like, you available? And I was like, yeah, go ahead, see my picture. And that's how I know I was working with Nicolas Cage for that Dog Eat Dog movie.
I haven't watched it yet. That's on Amazon, right? That's the one that's on Amazon Prime. But what was that like working? Were you just hand in hand with those guys, or kind of just on the other side of the set? What was it like working with big names?
It was surreal in a sense. Cause I was a feature extra, so I was like on it for that one scene, but it was so weird.
How you were in a scene of like, some stripper or something. There's a whole
strippers.
In like 10 seconds, this dude had more action in a movie than like most people that are like actually named characters.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. Cause I wasn't originally supposed to be in the same room with Nicolas Cage and Willem Dafoe doing a tape read. Mm-hmm. It just happened by Renee. Like, hey, we need you to come in for a fitting. I went into the building, and the one with the desk, she was like, hey, are you here for the fitting? I was like, and she's like, hey, you here for the movie? I was like, yes. So she's like, go in there to the room. So I'm thinking, this room is leading me to the fitting room.
Right.
I go in, it's like a long table. A couple people getting like coffee. I ain't think too much of it. I'm like, maybe it's like a waiting area. So I sit down. Next thing I know, I see Nicolas Cage coming through the door, bare belly, tattoos on his arm. Hey, hello. Hey, everybody. I'm just staring like, holy shit. It's Nicolas Cage. So I'm just looking at him as he's walking by getting his coffee. He looks at me, hey, how you doing? I'm like, Nicolas Cage just acknowledged me. This is gonna be good. And then they sit down, the other people come in, Willem Dafoe come in. So you got the director sitting right here, Nicolas Cage, Willem Dafoe, and I'm right beside Willem Dafoe. So I'm just like, holy fuck, this is amazing. So I'm having this table read with them. And before we got started, I told the director, I'm like, I'm here for a fitting. I don't think I'm actually here for the tarot read, but he was like, oh, you can stay. Yeah, just stay. And I'm like, okay, cool. This is gonna be pretty good.
So what's it like having dreadlocks? I've never had them, and I probably never will.
Well, I call them locks.
Locks?
Yeah. I miss them very much so. It's much easier. Well, I take that back. You think it's much easier just because you got your hair locked up and you can just wake up and just go, but you still have to take care of your hair. You still got to moisturize. You still got to, go to the barbershop or salon, whatever you choose, and, really get that dense cleaning your hair. So when you go bald, you just wake up, do whatever you got to do.
Is that why you ended up cutting them, started thinning out and decided not, or just want to go a different look? That has to be a hell of a day where you're like, I'm going to cut these.
Well, I did it slowly because I knew I was going to cut it eventually just because of my acting, because I want to be like stereo type cast. So I was like, I'm going to just do the sides first and just do some trendy looks. And there was a movie that came to town. This was 2017, I think. Yeah, 2017. and I could have been in this white boy rape movie. And they wanted me to be like the one of the Curry boys. It was like one of the gangs in the movie. But they wanted me to cut my locks at that time. I was like, not cutting my locks with that low pay. Like, right. They had to pay me a little bit more money than that for to cut my hair. So it took them weeks of going back and forth. But they had mentioned it with somebody else. I'm like, dang, man, that would have been nice just to talk with the director. And because the director really liked my look and he really wanted me in it, but the pay just wasn't
right
to cut it. I was like, all right, this probably gonna come up like in the future sometime, right. That it's gonna happen again. So I'm like, I'm gonna just do the size and then eventually just cut it all off.
And with that, do you have an agent or do you plan on getting an agent or just gonna keep going through word of mouth and build your way that way?
I'm non-union right now. And for the ones who don't know, non-union is just basically just your own entity. I haven't really looked for agencies because a lot of agents, they want, they gotta make money. So they right. want somebody who got like some type of
following and
buzz behind them. Non-union right now, but I know once I get to like LA or Atlanta, if possible, if I can just get into that SAG membership.
Screen Actors Guild?
Yeah, it's like $3,000 something for it. But if you get in that, then you can basically like get the same work as those big name time actors.
Just kind of, you pay that fee and then kind of just put your name into the hat to
yeah.
a casting director that's like, oh, I need somebody for this.
And it's, and like you have people who are like adding you for like different roles, so you don't have to do it yourself. They can just, oh yeah, I submitted you for 10 of these films, and if I hear something back, then that's how that SAG after stuff work.
Ohio's kind of, I think the little articles I see, aren't we kind of trying to do more like tax breaks and stuff to kind of yeah. bring more big films and stuff in?
Yeah, they passed a recent law, and that's why you got Cherry and that Untitled Friend have to move here now because of the tax credit. Well, the problem is they're not hiring any starring actors, but I guess since they're just bringing jobs to Cleveland, I guess it helps, but don't see them actually getting like a big production here though.
Right.
It probably will come, but no time soon I see it happening. Like you have a lot of casting agencies, but a lot of them are like for extras, and some of them do commercials, but they're like, you have the background casting agency, you have like the other ones who will find like commercial work for you. But those are like kind of a hit and miss. Like if they like you, they'll hire you, but
right.
or represent you, I should say. But if they don't really like you, or if you're too green, then they're like, try again in another couple
right.
months. But LA, you got like so many different filmmakers from schools, colleges, universities, and just.
Yeah. Seems just like more. I think you're oversaturated out there, but there's also a lot more funding out there. So it kind of like
yeah.
balances out that saturation and kind of allows talent to kind of get through, right?
Yeah.
So the last ones I got for you, if we'll pick this in a split question. If somebody wanted to check you out, or say, wink, wink, somebody like a podcast was helping promote some more of your stuff, if somebody could only watch one of your acting projects, what would you have them watch? Or if not only one, what would be that introductory of you to make them a fan?
It's two of them, but
only one.
If you have Amazon Prime, I'm sure many of you do, there's a movie called Banger that was shot here locally in Cleveland, and it has some big names in there. You got Pinky from Fridays in it. It's a lot of B-list celebrities. I'm in that movie, and I have about four or five scenes in the movie. It was a starring role. Check that out on Amazon. It's called Banger, B-A-N-G-E-R.
What type of parts do you like? You kind of do a little bit of anything that comes your way, or do you really want to go drama, comedy?
I think I can fit pretty much into, I'm a pretty versatile actor.
Mm-hmm.
But I really love fantasy. Like if I get a chance to start like in a fantasy movie where I got like a sword and some type of magic that's dealing with, I'll kill it. It's a villain or protagonist, whatever it may be, I love to do fantasy. I have done a couple comedy, like short films, so I do that pretty well. I think the one you probably least find me in probably be a romance, but I think I still can play it off well, but that'd probably be the least one that I want to do. But fantasy, comedy, thriller, action, those are like my favorite.
Gotcha. You also list that you're a cinematographer. Is that kind of what got you to get on YouTube and start making videos, both of music and getting into acting? Or was that because you liked acting that you wanted to get behind the camera?
A little bit of both. Like, acting was the most consistent thing, like, growing up that I wanted to do versus everything else. But I also love how movies were made and shot, and just that fantasy world, just to create whatever type of world that you want, intrigued me. So I went to Tri-C Metro Campus for media arts and digital filmmaking. So just so I can get that knowledge from behind the camera and also in front of it, so I can just flip-flop back and forth. So that's how I got into, you know, shooting music videos for other artists in Cleveland and doing other cinematography work. So,
you like shooting music videos, short films, movies, TV? Because you've kind of done a little, either been on one side of the camera or the other. What's your favorite medium?
I do love being behind the camera, just seeing how everything comes together. And I think cinematography is more so my favorite versus like directing, just because I get a chance to frame how I want everything to look. Mm-hmm. And I do like directing, I do like editing, but more so cinematography from behind the camera.
Did you learn more in film school or just kind of on a video set? What's a better learning environment for you?
Well, Tri-C was easy because it was more hands-on, versus like CSU where you got like a big classroom. CSU was like, not CSU, but Tri-C was pretty, so small, like 1 to 15 students in the class. So I think I got more experience behind the camera definitely at Tri-C because I was getting the actual professional cameras, then we had to go out and shoot stuff. Mm-hmm. And that was like for our grades. So I'll say for filmmaking, yes, definitely Tri-C.
If you could blow up in one of your mediums, whether you're, you know, big name rapper, big name movie star, but you could only pick one, which way do you go?
Definitely acting. Yeah, famous actor or successful actor.
And would you rather be TV actor, movie actor, short film? What if you had to pick one niche that you were just going to blow up?
Film. Yeah.
Full length?
Full length film, yeah.
And how many years until you foresee that happening?
Yeah.
I always look at everything like, if you have to figure out how to reverse engineer it. If you had to reverse engineer, how long is it going to take you?
To be successful or just be in that industry?
All you have to do is make those movies. You have to do no other jobs, no nothing. That level of success. Just pick the projects you want.
I would say about 4 or 5 years.
And are you going to relocate to do that? Are you going to have to move out to California? Can you do that through the Ohio scene?
It's like a very low percent chance to hear it because they only come here for extras. They don't really come here for like starring roles. So I have to go to like Atlanta or Los Angeles.
What is your biggest tip to either an actor or musician that's trying to promote themselves on social media?
Don't be afraid to put your work out there. I say it's the biggest one because a lot of people are afraid to really express themselves because they don't want to be like, what's the word I'm looking for?
Ridiculed?
I guess you can say ridiculed, yeah. But like, they don't want to feel like they're just in this corner. It's like, dang, everybody think my stuff is weird or some type of stigma. Just, it's okay to be yourself, promote yourself, put your content out there, because like that's gonna lead to something else. Like there's millions of people browsing these social medias. Like right. You never know who's gonna hit you up one day. So just don't be afraid to put your art out there.
I would definitely agree. And I'm in a lot of, because again, I have the Collins conversations, but Colin Can Help is the other brand that I'm working on getting out there. And that's more of just marketing, consulting, digital services, things like that. And it's amazing in the different podcast groups or blog groups. Oh, what do I do to build traffic? How do I get the audience? You know, like my favorite is, I want to start a podcast, but like, why are you making excuses when you could make content? And it's amazing. Like I think before we started rolling, I touched on it. It started out, it's put away, but I had this small little tiny gorilla tripod with that cell phone there that would sit on a table in front of a guest. And then I got to, from there, because again, I knew I was going to do it. I knew that podcasting and video things were where I needed to be for my marketing stuff. Mm-hmm. But I didn't have the money for that camera over there. I didn't have this laptop. And this is all a year ago. But each week, I had that. Then I got the $20 tripod. Now I'm not on the table. Now I'm above the table, right at eye level. I can do a swivel if I'm behind it. I got a lot more capabilities there. And then a couple episodes in that, I was like, the sound sucks. Like, the video is on point, but the sound is like, I hear everybody around me opposed to that. So then I got the Shure MV88. Plugs right into your lightning port multi-directional condenser mic, which I could be in the, we could be in the middle of Starbucks and you're hearing you and me and not all the other crazy stuff. I mean, a little bit of that obviously, but like that sound quality made a difference. And you know, a couple months went by, I got the camera, I got the laptop, and as all those things come together, I noticed each thing. Today we got the lights. Everybody, let me know how you like the lighting in this clip, because just learning lighting, but I think it makes a big difference in a tiny little test. I gotta edit it, but in the hour before you got here, I made an unboxing video of this. I got the full room almost set, and next thing you know, a smaller room in your house is a full fucking studio.
Yeah.
And a lot of people don't start because, oh, well, where do I record? How do I record? Just try it. If it works, cool. If you don't like the way it turned out, try it different. Or talk to somebody like yourself, to be like, hey, you do acting, like, how do I be more comfortable in front of a camera? Or you do music, what do I need to use for recording equipment? It's amazing how many people just are afraid to ask that question. And I think that's why this was originally the Colin Can Help podcast. Way too many fucking words. People didn't remember it. It didn't roll off the tongue, anything like that. Yeah. But that was also when it was kind of just started off with me just reading blogs of what I wrote and kind of just making the audio version. Because I'm a huge believer, everything needs to be in any medium that you can. It could be a graphic, a text, video, audio. Like, people learn different ways. And if I could have all my stuff on different, the similar message on any type of medium that you want, it's game over. You know, whether you're an audio guy, you're going to have my podcast. If you like to read, go to the blog. But it was that. And then I was like, this isn't working. You know, it's boring as fuck. Who wants to read it? Who wants to listen to a guy just, oh, well, this is a Walk for a Dog app review. You know, pretty, just talk about it. Come on, doggy, let's go. But then I realized getting guests is the biggest thing. Not only does getting a guest for your podcast create that much more content, it's not just what I want to create, it's whatever you said spurs a thought that I never had before. But then you got about 2,000 on Instagram, I got about 2,000 on Instagram. Everything that I put out from this conversation then has a 4,000 person audience for the both of us. One of those is like, oh, I want to talk to that guy because he puts everybody on. He finds quality people. He might know somebody for me to talk to. And they're like, wow, that guy had the exact look I was looking for a role.
Yeah.
And then all of those things align, and next thing, a year from now, you're making music with Ticey and Nuke, and I'm in a film as an extra just because you're like, hey, they need a funny looking white guy. Can you get down here in 20 minutes? I'm going to start winding it down here. You are the reason I spent about 2 hours today. Like I said, I always listen to Joe Rogan. But because of you, I made sure to go back to like 100 episodes ago when Andrew Yang was on. So that I could not be completely retarded knowing that you are the number one pro Andrew Yang rapper ever. You actually have at least 2 songs. Is that right about Andrew Yang?
3.
3?
Yeah.
What is it about Andrew Yang that you like?
I started by saying that I was never really into politics. Like 2008, I voted for Obama, but it was like it wasn't really for the policies, you know. Black man president. but earlier this couple months ago, I was just on Facebook and I saw this ad. It was like Asian man running for president wants to get every adult $1,000 a month. I'm like, the fuck?
Like, is this some clip?
What do we got here? I was like, I like it. I clicked on the video, watched a couple. I was like, it's making sense. Like, I'm gonna go on YouTube and see what's about him, and he really got me into politics and just like really like diving into like politicians, policies, how they affect everyone and the whole spiel. And I just, if you're gonna vote, check out Andrew Yang. Like, I'm telling you, like, there's over 160 policies that you can look at and see how it affects you. But just think, as a creative person, an artist or whatever, you know, media that you do, what an extra $1,000 a month would do for your business or for your artist budget. Like, all those people who need that money to fund like their albums or, you know, equipment that you need, like, that money will help jumpstart the creative arts industries like tenfold. So I think y'all should, you know, go check them out. Come part of the Yang Gang.
Yang Gang.
I got 3 songs on YouTube about Andrew Yang, and one of them went mini viral. It's like 6,000 views on Twitter and like 300 some retweets.
Did he retweet it?
He did. That's what I was hoping for. Like, oh, he got it through this now, but didn't see it. But eventually he'll
just keep sharing it. He'll see it eventually.
Yeah, he will.
When I first heard the idea of universal basic income, which what's he calling it now? The dividend?
Freedom dividend.
Freedom dividend?
Yeah.
It sounds asinine. You're like, people are already, like, as a business owner, I'm like, people are already lazy as fuck. Like, you give them an extra, granted, $12,000 is not a lot to live on, yeah. But, you know, you could live in a place like this, pay half the rent with a buddy, and pretty much not fucking go to work if you just wanted to, you know, pay your internet, have some cheap food, and, you know, just kind of play your games if that's what you wanted to. Yeah. Like, I think that's just the cynic. But then today when I was listening to him on Rogan, like, all right, so... yeah, that's a fucking $1.8 trillion or whatever they need to fund that. But if you could not have, you know, as much going into Medicare and all these other things, which are kind of, to me, wasteful. You know, I'm not political at all, but if I were to say I'm political, I'd go more libertarian. Kind of just leave me the fuck alone, let me do my thing, cut my taxes as much as you can, but, like, let's not be a dick to everybody. You know, like, if we could help them, let's help them. But I would always go Gary Johnson. I'm always about the kind of the... they got no fucking chance type candidate, but I like Gary Johnson because he actually had plans.
Yeah.
Like, he might not know where Aleppo or whatever they made fun of him for during that election was, but, you know, you're campaigning 18 hours a day and some moderator says an acronym, like, what does that mean? Or a city in the middle of nowhere. You're like, I don't have all the security briefs yet, but I got, this is what I'm going to do for this, this is what I'm going to do for this, or even a Hillary.
Yeah.
I didn't like her. But this is what she's gonna do for this. This is like, if you have a plan, let me vote for you off your plan opposed to just your rhetoric or mm-hmm. anything else.
Yeah.
Where the crazy freedom dividend, then you're like, oh, all right, well, he has a point. If you get 1,000, I get 1,000. Like you said, think about how many more creators would come do the service that I'm looking to sell them for $1,000 a month, which is ironic, the exact, my fee for full social media content management would fully be covered by every person that's making anything at that point.
Yeah.
Which for me, that $12,000 for free could be a $100,000 income to do exactly what I'm looking to do. Where they're taking it from other people, and some of his things are, he's a little out there, but everybody's out there, you know?
Yeah.
Do you think he's got a real chance?
I think my prediction is it's gonna be down to him, Warren, Bernie, and probably Joe Biden. It's like the last 4. Still head and head.
Then I'm taking that down to 2. I'm calling him and Bernie.
Most likely.
You think final 2?
Yeah, because Bernie and Yang is like the only ones that has like plans and like how to pay for stuff.
Right.
Like Warren, like she has like
craziness all
over. she's there like in the rim, like what needs to be changed, but like as far as like paying for things, like mm-hmm. she has no clue. Same with Joe Biden, definitely has no clue. He's just riding off of mama's name. So, like, if you had to choose either Bernie or Yang, like, those are the 2 just, like, most progressive.
Do you think they'd be smart enough to kind of, they're very similar on their policies. Do you think kind of Yang for president, Bernie for vice, or vice versa? Do you see that happening?
It's possible. It's just, there's, like, a lot of clash between the mm-hmm. 2 campaigns, especially on Twitter. But like I'm writing something now to put on Medium where it's like, hey, just look at the similarity these 2 got and just focus on that rather than like the differences. Because Yang was a Bernie supporter in 2016. So like most of the stuff is just Bernie's but improved to fit the 21st century.
Right.
Yeah.
It's also interesting to me because like, gang, amazing to me too with politics. Myself, I'm guilty of this as well, so I can kind of call myself out with this, but we're in the information age where it's never been easier to learn more things and do more research and everything else, and regrettably, I never even made it to the polls yesterday just because I knew I was so uninformed and I just, for whatever reason, didn't take I personally think you're better to not vote than to completely, like, just pick a name and just go circle boxes. Because at that point, when that guy does get elected and ruins the world, he's like, fuck. And I helped him. And, you know, like, I always make sure when it's the national one to actually take the time and do my research and things like that, which is so backwards because it's the local things that make more difference.
Yeah.
But with politics, you're a rapper and everything else that you do with politics. How can you get more people into Andrew Yang or to support anything in politics? Because it clearly is an important thing we're kind of lacking. Yeah.
It's like a huge, like, misinformation with politics. That most people think that their vote don't count, or
right. They're
like there's some type of like rigging in place where they're like, there's no point me to go vote if, you know, they're gonna rig it, whatever. A lot of it's just fear mongering, just so people want to show up to those ballots and actually, you know, vote. I think the best is, especially at local level, like, you, if you want to see change, like, in Cleveland, you want to see change, like, make sure you go and research these people who are sitting in, you know, the houses of these Senate, Congress, governors, like, actually research, see what their policies are, see how they affect you and everybody else, your family. And I think if more rappers, like, you don't gotta drop like a whole song about
right
a campaign, but just like, just throw a couple lines in there that's like politically charged, just so people can be like, I heard a little something in there about Sanders. Okay, I thought he was just this type of rapper, but I see he got, you know,
right,
some intellect behind that. And I just, music is filled with so much, I mean, everybody likes what they like, but like drugs and like,
right,
overdoses, like so much like stuff. And of course, that has its own lane, but just, if you're gonna do that, we throw some policies in there or some business stuff or just something just so people can get fed that type of information. Because, like, even they're not paying attention, they're gonna be like, dang, I remember that one song that blah 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 said that mentioned this, and now I'm paying attention to it. It's just, I guess politics isn't really looked at as cool in a sense, especially with the younger folks. But I think it's going to change this time around, because more and more high school kids, especially with the climate change stuff, like, you can drop a few lines about climate change, you might get on Times Magazine or something. Like, that can really propel your career, like, different areas and reach, you know, powerful people who own these agencies and stuff.
Right, yeah. Like you said, if not do a whole, you know, this is my Democrat album, but, you know, to kind of, instead of just, you know, selling drugs and the economics of that, if you could figure out how to stay on a corner and not go to jail and flip a profit, you could also figure out how to go to Robin Hood, type in your my code, get a free stock, and then turn that into more and more and more. It's kind of just take that trap hip-hop fun vibe and throw dividends and Andrew Yang. Just really, I mean, it's kind of what you do to then also got on my radar to be like, oh, this isn't just a fucking SoundCloud rapper that's just like, I got Xanax, I got hoes, I got it all, man. And you're like, oh, I want to have this guy in my house and, you know, have a full-on conversation. But when you could see...
I can't dress like that, just to...
like, yeah, this guy really is all over the board. What am I doing with him? But, you know, to kind of have that substance also then makes you more marketable to not just do music.
Yeah.
Like you said, you dropped Medium. I was ready to wrap the thing down. I'm like, fuck, is he gonna have a book out now too?
I'm writing a novel.
I've got one book on KDP, Amazon for sale. It's a Google Analytics study guide. Beginning of the year, I was kind of doing more stuff with authors because as the marketer, I was like, all right, the more authors I could put on, I was in the Amazon, just got in the Amazon affiliates program at the time. So it was like, if I could promote their books, maybe get some Amazon pennies out of it, I could help them. No author or musician understands how to market themselves, in my removed opinion. You know, it's 2019 and most of you guys don't have fucking websites of your own.
Yeah.
I think you're included in that group, aren't you?
I have one. It's just...
Did I miss it? Is it not easily found?
My main one is my DeAndreBush.com.
Gotcha. But, like...
I don't have, like, Vist.com, because another company overseas own that domain.
Fuckers.
Yeah. they were going after me with it, but...
But you know what I mean? It's one of those, a lot of people think with social media that everything's like, oh, just go find me on Instagram, go find me on Twitter. But then, if I could just then take that, that's great. But if Instagram goes down, you can't do anything. If Twitter, not saying that these big, huge entities are just disappearing,
yeah.
But what I've kind of geared myself towards is still posting on all those couple times a day, but saying, hey, here's a snippet. Go to ColinCanHelp.com for the full thing, because once you go to ColinCanHelp.com, if you were to go click any of the advertisements, I'm going to get some money off of that. Opposed to, you could click my shit all day on Instagram,
yeah.
Could build up 100,000 followers, it's not making me any money, you know, like it's kind of working through the funnel. Oh, but back to books, that's what, I forgot how I got off that. I was working with authors, and they're all doing the KDP, the self-publishing thing, and I was like, to really understand how to help them with this process, I kind of have to go through it. I don't read hardly any books. I'm not really, that's not how I learn. I'd rather either the audio version or watch it or whatever.
Yes.
But I was like, all right, I got to do it. And one weekend I went and passed all the Google certifications just to kind of help build my marketing brand. And I was like, there's no reason you should have to watch as many videos as you do. So I just went through, and every question and answer I put into kind of a statement. So I wasn't, you know, stealing verbatim of what the test was, but if you read all my statements, you're going to get 100% on all these tests. So then I've actually sold 55, I think, copies. I don't hardly ever promote it or anything, but by...
That's from affiliate marketing, right?
No, that's just from people buying that book.
Yes.
I'd actually almost make more than a penny, I think, if you were to click my link and then buy my book through my link. Kind of figure out how to piggyback on those, you know? I'm all about that. Like, hey, Mom, are you ordering anything? Well, give me a heads up, you know? Let me send you a link.
I'll be sending it to my friends. I'm like, yeah, I ain't gonna be buying nothing online.
Holidays are coming up, everybody.
I got a share sale account. I can make a commission off it.
Right? The one I got now on ColinCanHelp.com, I think, I hope will do well. If I can get people to keep looking at it, is, I think it's $8 or $10. I can get maximum off of if you buy an Amazon gift card through the little, you know, text box.
Yeah.
How many people are buying Amazon gift cards for the holidays? So if I can get enough traffic just to come to my site and then see, oh, fuck, I do need a gift for Mom, Amazon Prime. Or that's what it was. It wasn't a gift card. It's if I could get somebody to sign up for Prime, it's like $8 or $10.
Yeah.
Which everybody wins there. Everybody has Prime. So why not get the gift through me, help me out, so I could put that money into making more content. You still get your Prime account. Everybody wins.
Yeah.
And people hate Amazon for some reason.
A lot of people think it's like scams. Like, oh, they're scams.
Yeah. And you're like, no, it costs you nothing extra.
Yeah.
I make money, and it allows me to do what I want instead of have to go do the other jobs that I don't want to do. So how I end every interview, I'm going to get up and kind of refocus this camera. I call this the digital soapbox. It's your way to end the interview on any way that you want to do. Whether you want to go promotional, inspirational,
closing statement.
You already know.
I'm a politician now.
Andrew Yang, type 2.
Close this down. How many seconds are
there? You get 1 minute.
Oh, 1 minute. Yeah, that's definitely a closing statement.
Use all of it, half of it, whatever you want to go. Start whenever you're ready.
Thank y'all for watching Colin Can Help podcast. Shout out to Colin for having me on today. A lot of you may have seen me around somewhere in Cleveland, because a lot of people said it to me, like, I've seen you somewhere before, because I'm literally everywhere. If you are an actor, don't be afraid to reach out to me on just on my social media, Instagram, particularly DeAndre Bush. You can just type me in to find me if you have any questions. I pretty much do a little bit of everything creative art, so if anybody out there want to collab on something or just need some advice, I'm open to do that for you. If you aren't into politics, make sure you research your politics. Also, go check out Andrew Yang. Think about what $1,000 a month would do for you. But please follow me on my Instagram, Twitter, DeAndre Bush. Check out my music, Visk, V-I-S-Q. You can find me on YouTube. Literally, I'm everywhere on the internet, so you will find me somewhere. Either you just type in Visk or DeAndre Bush.
Perfect.